Divine Truth Interviews. Jesus, Mary, and others are interviewed by members of the media and the public. Jesus is interviewed by Mary Magdalene on the topic of how the human soul functions. The interview was held on the 15th of April 2014 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is Session 3, Part 1.
G'day, Mary and I today continuing our discussion about how the human soul functions. So hopefully you've been enjoying the discussions up till now. I know we've been quite windbags about in our previous discussions.
We're fairly passionate about this topic.
It's a very important topic that we want to discuss with you, because we feel quite strongly that unless you know how the human soul functions, you don't know why things occur between your soul, your physical body, and your spirit body. So it's very important to know how your human soul functions. Now, what we'd encourage you to do before listening to this particular session is to look at session one, which was done in April last year, April 2013, and then session two, which we did last week, which is in April 2014, before you actually look at this session, which was session three on the subject. In the first session, we basically discussed the principles of all of the different parts of how the human soul functions in terms of the ideas or concepts. And in the second two sessions, last week and this week, what we're trying to do is just to give you more information about those particular concepts and belief systems in terms of how we can bring these concepts into reality in our day-to-day life, and questions about how it works or how it looks like in our day-to-day life. So that's our primary focus with this session, and it was also our primary focus with the last session that we did last week. So now what we're going to do is discuss the last three concepts. We discussed the first, I think it was four or five concepts last week, and now we're going to discuss the last three concepts as a part of this introduction about how the human soul functions. So hopefully you enjoy our company while we do that.
Today I'm here with Jesus, and we're continuing our discussion of how the human soul functions. And the next section we will discuss will be on the principle of resistance.
Yes, so. Interesting principle of resistance. Everyone needs to know about resistance.
I feel like I already know a lot about resistance.
Most people know about resistance all of their life. Yeah. So, but unfortunately, most people don't know it from a soul-based perspective. They don't understand why they're resisting, and they don't understand what resistance does to their soul, you know, how it affects their soul, and what goes on inside of the soul, physically goes on inside of the soul when you resist.
Yeah.
Because it precludes truth from entering you. Of course, you can also resist error. Yeah, so it can also preclude error from entering you. So it's a very important thing to understand about how resistance works.
Yeah, so would you be happy to read us the principle as you've outlined it in the document, and then we can discuss it a little bit? Because it actually works in a almost in a positive and a negative direction, as you've just alluded to, doesn't it?
Correct, yeah. Correct. So let's read the principles. So resistance is the principle that truth enters the soul when there is no emotional impediment, as error, resisting the absorption of the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Error enters the soul when there is no emotional impediment, as truth, resisting the absorption of the error. Emotional impediments are under the control of the will of the individual, in that the will can be exercised to emotionally release the reason for resistance. And this is a part of humility. So that we've got a fair bit to discuss,
yes,
about that.
We do.
I'll read the other two paragraphs first and then we can do the discussion.
Okay.
This principle defines the reasons for the inability to absorb, which is resistance, in that all absorption, whether truth or error, occur due to emotional openings within the soul. Emotional openings that have been created by the will of the individual to emotionally release the resistance. Emotional impediments of error are created by the soul being unable to fully utilize its mind and other attributes, especially love and humility, to resist the absorption of the impediment. This especially occurs during childhood, while the emotional and intellectual development of the soul is yet to mature.
Mm.
So let's look at the first part, the first paragraph, and maybe discuss that a little. What we're basically saying is that for something to enter the soul, there has to be inside of the soul no emotional impediment for that to enter. Mm-hmm. And if there is an emotional impediment, that is resistance.
Yep.
So all resistance is an emotion that exists within the soul already. Now, you can have resistance to truth, and so that's an emotion that exists in the soul that says, I can't accept that truth. And then you can also have resistance to error. In other words, you can have an emotion in the soul that says, I can't accept that error.
Yeah.
And we need to understand that. So resistance can be positive when we're resisting errors, or it can be very counter-positive or negative by the fact that we resist truth. But all resistance occurs because of the emotional impediment in the soul that causes the resistance. Mm-hmm. Or you could say the emotion in the soul that precludes the truth from entering or the error from entering.
And it really, as you go on to say, this is the reason that, like, preclusion means that it exists there already, but the reason there is resistance for new things entering.
So a resistance to absorption.
Yes.
If we use the terminology we've been using.
Yeah. Is because there is an emotion that opposes it already within us.
Correct.
And so truth creates resistance to error, and error creates resistance to truth.
Only if it exists as an emotion within us.
Yes.
Not if it exists as an intellectual concept. And this is where most people become very confused. Because what happens is they often hear a concept that they agree with and then they go, oh, I believe that. No, you don't. You don't believe it until all the emotional resistance inside of you about that concept has gone. Then you believe it. Yeah. Only then.
Only then when the truth enters you emotionally.
Correct.
Yes.
It's only when the truth enters you emotionally that you can actually fully believe and accept that truth.
Yeah.
And this is where I see most people making terrible errors when it comes to the path of divine truth.
Yeah.
They think that they've heard something, so that means they've changed. No, it means you've heard something and you remember it. That's all it means, nothing else.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you've changed. Change can only occur when the emotional reasons inside of you that you are not changing are released,
mm-hmm.
which is all about the process of feeling those emotions and experiencing those emotions.
Yeah.
And we talked about that principle, didn't we, last week? The principle of progression, which is the principle of releasing the emotions that are preventing progression, basically, and allowing the emotions that will cause progression to enter you.
Yeah.
And you can't have the emotions that would cause your progression enter you unless you release the emotions that prevent your progression on that subject.
Which is the resistance. So while the emotion that is in opposition is within you and you're trying to absorb, say there's error within you on a certain subject and you're trying to absorb truth. Upon it, there will be resistance while
Correct.
That emotion...
And you need to give up absorption. You need to just give it up. You need to say, I can't absorb this until I release something. And if you focus your attention on releasing something, rather than focusing your attention on absorbing something when there's an impediment there, you'll have far more success and progress on the divine truth path.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
You'll have far more success also progressing towards God and receiving God's love. Because while you could think of the resistance process as blockage to the truth entering, right? Now, we can try to get this truth and we can try to absorb it somehow, but there's this firm feeling inside of us preventing its absorption. And so what most of us do then is we say, oh, it's in my mind, I'm right.
Yep.
But there's these firm ideas and concepts and beliefs inside of our soul as emotions that prevent this truth that we now acknowledge in our mind from ever being acknowledged in the soul.
Yeah.
And this is the problem. We need to give up trying to even acknowledge it in our mind, and we need to connect with, what does my soul really feel? What is the real feeling inside of me that prevents me from automatically absorbing this truth? So, for example, if I'm afraid, What's the real feeling inside of me that causes my fear to remain? What belief systems, ideas and concepts inside of me cause me to hold on to my fear and cause it to remain inside of my soul? Obviously, I need to focus on feeling those, because then I'll feel the fear. When I feel the fear can release itself through emotional process, and I'll be crying probably, feel it shaking, crying, doing all sorts of things during that process, which may last many hours or days. And then after that is gone, the truth on that particular issue can enter my soul, if I allow it, if I want it. So sometimes we don't want it.
Yeah.
Sometimes we let go of errors, but we don't want the truth. Mm-hmm. So we need to work through that as well, because if I don't want the truth, that is another resistance. There's an emotion in me that causes me to not want that resistance. I need to find that emotion that causes me to be resistive to feeling that truth. Yeah. And that could be rebellion, you know, a feeling of rebellion or other types of emotions. And we need to allow ourselves to experience these emotions, as because they are impediments to our growth. And this is why we say the next thing, where we said emotional impediments are under the control of the will of the individual.
Yeah.
In that the will can be exercised to emotionally release the resistance or the reason for resistance. This is where I see most people not understanding, like, love or truth. They do not allow themselves to emotionally resist the reason why there's resistance. What they do is they seek for it intellectually, rather than just trying to feel it emotionally. So they go, oh, maybe it's this, or maybe it's my dad did that, and when I was little, my mum did that. You can know a whole heap of things about your past in your head, but unless you're prepared to feel them, the emotional resistance will not release. And if the emotional resistance does not release, absorption is impossible. Mm-hmm. So you won't be able to absorb a new truth. And therefore, you will not be able to progress.
Yeah.
Simple as that.
I often have tried to sort of relate my experience with dealing with addiction to other people. I mean, emotional addictions here. Because a lot of people encounter, oh, I've got this addiction with men where I want their attention all of the time and all of these things. They encounter that knowledge intellectually. Mm-hmm. And then often they judge it. Mm-hmm. They try to modify that behaviour, mm-hmm. and because they can see it's not right, or they search, as you said, for the cause with their dad and try to feel that. Mm-hmm. But really my experience with addiction is that when I have an addiction, I have an erroneous belief inside of me that I should be able to get this thing. Mm-hmm. And that is what I have to feel. Mm-hmm. That is what creates the resistance to my change, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. I have a belief or a feeling that I should be able to get this and avoid the underlying emotion.
Yes.
And the only real progress I feel I've ever made in dealing with addiction is when I've let myself feel how much I want it and not act to fulfill it, but feel how much I want and feel the...
And feel it without judgment.
Yes, without judgment. Mm. Just recognise it's an emotion that is within me that needs to be felt.
Yep.
And that releases some of the resistance I have to continuing the process.
Correct. And as a result of the release of that resistance, there is a release of some of the fear that generates the addiction, and so the addiction lessens.
Yeah.
And this is what we need to understand. No change can take place unless an emotional process is engaged where something is released.
Yes.
And I mean no change in either direction. You can't let go of error and absorb truth unless you release some of the emotion that contains the error. Yeah. And you can't let go of truth and absorb an error without you releasing some of the emotion that contains the truth.
Yes.
In other words, and you can progress or
regress. Yeah.
Depending on which direction you use your will. So resistance is not all bad, because there are things that in your soul that eventually you'll resist greatly.
Yeah.
In other words, you'll have such a strong concept of love and truth inside of your soul that it will be impossible for a false belief to enter you on that subject. And that's great.
This is the really cool bit about this principle, I reckon, is the way that it is actually a very positive thing. When truth comes to reside in our soul, it will resist the error and that makes you rock solid.
Correct.
And that's awesome, because who wants more error?
And who wants to, you know, it wouldn't be very nice if we absorb some truth and then next week it's all gone again. Because, you know what I mean, in our soul, I mean. Yep. Obviously, you can do that in your mind. You can absorb some truth and next week you act totally out of harmony with it. And in fact, if you are acting totally out of harmony with what you believe you should be acting, it's because it hasn't entered your soul yet.
Yeah.
If it enters your soul, it's impossible to act out of harmony with what's in the soul, right? And that applies to the error as well. Like, we need to understand that we're going to continue acting in harmony with the error. And it's going to be impossible to act out of harmony with the error until we release why we have the error.
Yeah. Right?
So we need to give up the concept that we can force ourselves intellectually into having a different concept. And we need to start focusing on, okay, the only real way for me to change is for me to let go emotionally of the error that I believe. And that means going through the experience of that emotional error. So...
Yeah.
So, for example, if you have a lot of rage with men, you're going to have to go through that rage with men. You're not going to be able to intellectually skip over that rage and then progress, because you won't progress. Your soul won't progress. There might be intellectual changes that occur inside of you, but there'll be no soul progress at your soul level. In terms of your condition, you'll arrive in exactly the same condition that you would have arrived if you hadn't have done the work intellectually.
Yeah.
So it's pointless.
In fact, often doing the work intellectually creates a sort of impediment, doesn't it?
Yes. A further impediment of resistance to what's going on in your soul.
Yeah.
And this is where it's critical that people understand, if you want to be on the path to God, you must understand your soul.
Yes.
And to understand your soul, you must understand that unless something that's an error in you releases, and there are a lot of ways to release it, there are some ways you can do by yourself, and there's some ways you can do with God's help. But unless you release it, you will not change. Mm. And you will not absorb the new truth you think you have until, and it won't be a part of your very life or your very being until you absorb it. And absorption is impossible while you've got something in you that causes you to resist the absorption.
And that is really, you're saying that your life won't be different. That is the principle of dominance that we discussed last week. Your soul will dominate. It doesn't matter what you think.
Yep.
If that exists within you,
And this is why you get people who have the highest intellectual ideals, put them in a situation that is like emotionally distraught or traumatic, and they revert back to what their soul will do. And if their soul will murder, they'll murder. If their soul will rape, they'll rape. If their soul will pillage, they'll pillage, you know, as the saying goes. And they'll do any of those things because the actual soul hasn't changed. And you put a person in a situation that where they're under trauma or under pressure, they will generally always revert back to whatever the soul is. And that's the principle of dominance. It will always be the case. And we need to understand that that will occur. So we need to give up this concept that we can intellectually change. We can use our intellect to help change. You know, certainly we can do that. But we can't change using our intellect to change without any emotional work.
Yeah.
We can't do that.
Yeah.
It's impossible. And we need to understand it's impossible and give up trying. You know, I see a lot of people still trying to do that.
Yeah.
And while you're trying to do that, stagnation is going to be the only result.
Mm-hmm.
No progression can occur unless there is the release of the resistance to absorption.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is where... You were talking earlier about how it's possible to do the intellectual work. And some years ago now, I did a workshop with people called Opening to God. And on the first morning, it was all about getting real about God.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the first activities was connecting to our anger with God.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually met with quite a bit of resistance from people in the group saying,
I don't have any anger.
I'm not angry with God. God is love. God is loving. And I would always meet that with saying, are you at one with God? Like, no. So you have some issues with God. You have some baggage with God. Otherwise, you'd already be in this faithful, totally in the, you know, throes of God's love right now.
Yeah.
But this is where I can see where people do intellectual work, trying to absorb God is love. But they haven't released the error that resists that entering them in their soul.
Mm.
And so this And yet then they have intellectual resistance to connecting to the emotional resistance.
Yeah, but even that's driven by another emotion.
Well, it's got to be driven by fear or other emotional errors, doesn't it?
Correct. Because the way the soul works is that our mind is really just a tool the soul uses.
Yeah.
And if we understand that better, we can see that when the mind goes into I don't believe that or I don't do that, you know, I don't agree with that, it's just responding to the soul's desire to not believe, the soul's desire to not understand. And why would the soul desire to not understand something that's loving and truthful? It's only because the soul has some fear about it that it's not willing to either connect to or feel.
Yeah.
And this is where we need to understand that every time we say, oh, no, I get that, when your life is demonstrating that you don't get it,
yeah,
you're really convincing yourself away from progression, mm-hmm, because you're basically saying, I'm already progressed, right, when you haven't. And it's pointless doing that. That's one step further back. To convince yourself you're progressing when you're not is a very it's delusionment, mm-hmm, you know. And it's self-deluding to consider that you're more progressed than you actually are. And the only person or the main person that you're harming is yourself in that regard. You're far better off going, okay, if I look back over my life, I have not changed on this subject, you know, whatever the subject may be. Like, it could be, like, if you're a man, it could be that every time your wife asks you to go and do something down the shop, you get angry, right? So you haven't changed on the subject.
No.
You can convince yourself you're more loving now, whatever, but the reality is nothing's changed. So that tells you that you're resistive to this in your soul somehow. And there's some kind of resistance that's out of harmony with love inside of your soul that's causing you to hold on to some old belief system that's causing you to be resistive to progressing to the point where you're not angry about it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like if you're a woman with regard to sex and you feel like every time your husband gets a bit amorous or your partner gets a bit amorous, you feel like, oh, you know, I feel a bit pushed now. I feel like he's being pushy now. Well, there's some resistance. If you haven't changed in that in the last 5 years, then I suggest to you, there's something in your soul that's causing that. And you need to get to that thing in your soul that's causing mm-hmm. that rather than convincing yourself you're all over it now and it's your husband's problem, you know.
Yeah.
And this is what we constantly do too when we live with other people. We have a tendency, oh, it's his problem or her problem or that problem. They shouldn't have been living with me or they shouldn't have done that and that's why I feel the way I feel. No, it's not. You feel the way you feel because there's resistance in your soul that's preventing you to progress in love. And if you allow yourself to release that, you'll progress. You'll make actual progress.
Mm.
And if you understand that, your focus wouldn't be on intellectually trying to grasp something or trying to, you know, have a look at a long list of all the commandments you need to follow and do it every day. You wouldn't be focused on those things. You would be focused on finding out why you're resistive in your soul.
Yeah.
And you'd want to feel that. You'd want to feel the resistance.
Yes. And you said something crucial there. You said about allowing yourself to connect to these feelings.
Yes.
And even more crucially, you said earlier that it's under the control of the will of the individual. It's
yes.
not something where you just find it and then you just... You have to want to do this thing.
Yeah, I see a lot of people going, they have this sort of viewpoint, oh, yes, I have that, but I don't know why. And the
yeah.
answer is it's in your soul. That's why it's happening. And you're resistive to letting it out. That's why it's happening. And then they go, but there's this constant viewpoint that we hear from many people. Oh, I don't know why that's happening to me. It must be something to do with my mum or my dad or the energy from the world or,
yep.
you know, some kind of... No, it's because it's in your soul and that's why.
It's
quite simple. God made a very simple, progressive soul and God made it very simple to understand once you get the basics.
Yep.
And I feel most people don't get the basics because they're resistive to even getting the basics because they don't want to feel.
Mm.
That's the biggest problem. They don't want to feel. Opening your heart to feeling is going to be one of the biggest and most challenging bits of work you have to do to improve your soul.
Tell me about it.
Mm.
It really is the key to everything because until we start that deep feeling process, that desire, we let go of the resistance that we have to being in a feeling state.
Mm.
The false beliefs and the errors that we hold on to about that feeling state.
Mm.
Until we do that, very little progression, if any, can actually happen.
Yeah, well, no real soul progression can happen.
And it can only happen to the extent that you allow some feeling, which is very different to allowing yourself to be in a feeling state all of the time, isn't
correct.
It?
Correct. Yeah. We need to allow ourselves to be overwhelmed with feeling. And this is very, very difficult for most people, given that we've all been brought up on a diet of suppressing feelings.
Yeah.
So that's our, you know, the world's diet is suppress, suppress, suppress your feelings, keep yourself under control. You're not allowed to express anything that's out of line with whatever your parents think is out of line. Mm-hmm. And as a result, we grow up only expressing emotions that our parents think is okay to express. And for the majority of parents, that's not many emotions. And so we grow up very, very limited. Our soul is very limited in its ability to express itself emotionally. And we can express ourselves emotionally in a safe environment, but we use the excuse that, oh, I'll go crazy if I express myself, or, oh, you know, that emotion will be never-ending if I express it, or whatever it is. We have literally thousands of excuses that have all been created by our environment generally to cause us to not go through the emotional process of expressing our soul.
Yeah.
And not confronting the reasons why we have little expression of our soul. And it's all to do with our inability to allow ourselves to be emotionally overwhelmed with any emotion. We are totally shut down to that process, most of us. And we need to go through a process of opening that up. See, love is an emotion coming from God, and you can't experience it unless you start opening yourself up to emotion. And you are going to be overwhelmed by God's love if you allow the emotion. But if you can't allow yourself to be overwhelmed by anything emotionally, you're going to struggle with receiving any of God's emotion. And if you struggle receiving God's emotion, then it's impossible for you to grow towards God. Like, you can grow maybe intellectually and maybe physically and maybe in other areas, but your soul is not going to grow.
And really those other growths, you know, by saying, oh, you can grow intellectually or physically or whatever, we can't even call that real growth, can we? Because the soul has dominance.
Correct.
So it's temporary changes at best.
Yes. And this is why the majority of people that we've met who have listened to Principles of Divine Truth for 6 or 7 years have had little growth, because they've been unable yet, through the exercise of their own will,
this is important.
They've been unable and unwilling to connect to the true emotions that are in their soul. And to get to from a state to be willing requires in itself processing through some emotions of being unwilling.
And that's releasing the resistance to the truth that this is under the control of my will, that this will lead to growth, that this is a good
it's
idea.
It's not some magical process that I can rely on at some point in my future that'll fix me. And all of those other false beliefs that we have all need to be gotten rid of. And the only way we can get rid of them is by feeling them. So we got to feel, I want this to be easier. You know, that's one feeling, one rageful feeling that we're going to have to go through.
Yeah.
It is actually quite easy once you get through that feeling. That's the irony. And this is the process with a lot of these feelings. Once you get through the feelings, you find the absorption process much, much easier. And you actually start progressing. But if you're not willing to be honest about the real feeling or feel the real feeling, no progression is ever going to occur, no matter how much intellectual knowledge you have. And that's something we need to understand. And this principle of resistance is very important to understand, just like all the other principles, because they show you what's going on inside of your soul.
Yeah.
Yeah. For the average person, except for children, there is a large amount of resistance. In children, there is no resistance to error or truth.
So let's clarify that. You're saying there's a large amount of resistance in every adult.
Yes.
But that doesn't necessarily mean resistance to truth
or
to error.
It's just
resistance.
Resistance that sometimes is in operation with truth and sometimes is in operation with error. Does that make sense?
So it's really emotions. Emotions and belief systems.
Which are all emotional.
All belief systems are emotional. Yeah. Within every adult.
Yes.
Whether they think it's there or not, there is beliefs and feelings about just about every topic you could ever think of.
Any topic you can imagine, most people have a belief about it already, firmly entrenched by the time they're 7 years of age, by their environment and particularly by their parents.
Yes.
And if not by their parents, by the society they're living in, by the school that they grew up went to whatever. They have all of these belief systems, true or false, belief systems inside of them as emotions now. And while they're inside of them as emotions, now they have resistance. Yeah, some of it's resistance to truth, some of it's resistance to error.
Yeah. And this is why many people on earth believe that change isn't possible, is because nobody ever confronts resistance.
Correct.
So they don't change.
The majority of people on earth don't change their entire life after the time they're 7 or 8 years of age. And the main, they might grow up a bit. You know, they might intellectually dominate some of their emotional feelings, but from a soul perspective, they don't change. And it's very interesting when you have a look at the iris of a person, you will see the eye reflects the soul's condition. And by the time a person is usually 7 years of age, after then, the iris very rarely changes negatively or positively,
mm-hmm.
interestingly enough. And that is because most of it is firmly fixed by that time inside of the soul, and they then just act out the rest of their life based on what is firmly fixed inside of the soul. Now, that doesn't have to be the case, but it is the case for the majority, well, pretty much for everyone on the planet, mm. until they understand these principles at a soul level. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So do you want to keep discussing the next paragraph, or go into some questions and things that I had about that?
Yeah, I just want to make maybe one more statement about the will.
Yeah.
We need to, pardon me, understand the power of the will. Like, most people don't even honour their own will. When I say don't honour their own will, they don't go, okay, this is what I currently believe, but I can will a change through the release of the emotional impediment as to why I believe this thing, and will that I accept the truth about this particular thing. I can go through this process. It doesn't mean that you can sit there and go, I'm going to release the error now, it's all released, oh, I'm going to accept the truth now, it's all gone, without any emotional process, because you have to have an emotional process in order to release the impediment, the resistance, to the absorption of a new truth. But you can use your will to do such a thing.
Mm.
Most people don't. They sort of go, oh, okay, no worries. Yeah, I could change, but I'm not too, I'm a very laissez-faire usually. You know, they don't care very much about change, and they don't really see it's a problem of what they believe, many people initially, so there's no exercise of a will there. Or they believe that releasing the error is going to be of major trauma to them, so they don't want to release the error, or whatever other ways they are exercising their will. And we're usually exercising our will very negatively, even to the point where we say we're not even responsible for what's in us. We go, okay, my parents caused or my society caused this emotion that's in me. They should have to get rid of it. No, it's in you. Only you, through your will now, can get rid of it.
Yeah.
That's the only person now who is capable of going through the emotional release process that will release this particular problem, this resistance to the absorption of new truth. So you're going to have to do it, whether you like it or not. And it doesn't matter how many people created it, you now have to let it go through a process that you must go through yourself without anybody helping you and without anybody assisting you. Now, when I say without anybody helping and assisting, obviously there are people around who understand this process here and in the spirit world who can help you understand the process, but they can't make you feel it. Only you can choose to feel it. And if you don't choose to feel it, no change is possible.
Mm.
No change. So you'll be here 20 years time going, why haven't I progressed? Well, because you have used your will to not progress. And this is the biggest problem with people's relationship with God. They have used their will to resist it without understanding how their will is exercised. And I feel that's a big issue.
Yeah. I agree.
Mm.
So resistance is really under the control of our will.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about change is only possible through the release of resistance.
Yes.
As adults.
We'll
talk about kids a bit later, maybe
yes.
a bit more.
Yeah.
But what I find interesting is that I see many people engaged in a... You talked about people who are very lackadaisical about change, people who don't really care about change. But then I see on the planet there are some people who are involved in a desire to change themselves or their environment or have a career or, you know, these things. But we're not engaged, we're engaging our will while trying to deny the soul.
Which is like
the dominance,
which is like trying to change while your soul is not wanting to change. That's pretty hard. In fact, it's impossible. You can't do it.
Yeah.
And that's why hardly anybody ever changes. Even when they think they're using their will.
Yeah.
Hardly anybody changes because they're not really using their will. They're not feeling what's inside as resistance.
Hmm.
They're not choosing to feel that resistance.
Hmm.
They want to feel the good thing. See, not much of the resistance when it comes to error feels good. It all feels hurtful, shameful, hard, angry, fearful. It's all yucky emotions that the average person on earth goes, I don't want to feel any of those emotions. I only want to feel good, happy, you know, joyful, whatever. I don't want to feel sad or afraid or angry. And see, resistance is very rarely sad. It's mostly angry. It's mostly angry, fearful and shameful and those kind of emotions. And they are the emotions that the majority of people on the planet want to avoid at all costs. You know, people will murder to avoid those emotions, generally. And as a result, there's very little change, even though they might try to say to themselves, oh, I'm going to be a force for good in the world. You can't be a force for good in the world until you're ready to change your own soul and you understand how it works. And unless you're willing to let go of what's error inside of your own soul, how can you ever be a force for good in the world? Because what is in your own soul as error will exercise its dominance. So, you know, give up the whole concept of trying to be a force for good in the world and try to be a force that feels its own resistance. And you'll make some progress, you know. And I feel that's what the majority of us need to do. And it's the expression, if you can see resistance as the expression of the soul's will, that's really, really important. Like, do you understand what I mean by that?
Yeah, you're just saying so many things. I keep having to write down things I want to go back to that you said.
Well, maybe we better go back to some of the things first and then we'll go forward.
No, go with what you're saying and I'll just write a note.
Okay. So if you think about it, using your soul to resist something is an expression of your will, just like using your soul to desire something is an expression of your will.
Yep.
Right? So if we can see using resistance as an expression of our will, then we know that if we're stagnant, that we're using our will to be stagnant. And then we could ask ourselves the question, well, why am I using my will that way? And the only real logical answer can be because I'm afraid to actually progress.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then we could ask ourselves, well, what are the feelings of fear?
What's the false beliefs I have about that? Yeah.
Yeah. But also I need to do one even better thing. The fear is a feeling that causes us to express our will in resistance to truth. So the only way we're going to actually progress is to feel the fear and not talk about it anymore. We need to feel it. So we can go through the intellectual exercises of what is this fear about and so forth. We might even know what it's about intellectually. But unless we feel it, no progression is going to happen. So I know at some point I'm going to have to get from I see that I'm afraid of that into I am afraid of that and I feel that, you know, and I'm feeling it and I'm crying because I'm so afraid of it and so forth. I'm going to have to get to that point to release the resistance.
Mm-hmm.
And I can intellectually do these gymnastics saying, oh, yeah, I know that. No, you don't know anything yet until you've felt the resistance go, until you feel it leave you, which is through an emotional experience that's going to be quite traumatic. Anything associated with shame, guilt, fear, anger are all going to be traumatic emotional experiences, painful to experience.
Mm.
And we can't, and this is what I said last time we got together, I think, this addiction to avoid pain is a major problem.
Big problem.
A big problem on the planet.
Yeah.
We need to have an addiction to experiencing everything. That would be great, including experiencing pain.
Yeah. Then it wouldn't be an addiction, though.
Of course, it wouldn't be an addiction because we'd be experiencing everything. Yeah. But it'd be wonderful if we all changed our viewpoint about pain. See, what we're most to do most of the time is we want to blame everything else for our pain. We don't want to feel it.
Mm.
We want other people to make it go away. That's bad, you know. We want to feel our pain. That's going to be the thing that makes us progress. Yep. Now, you had a whole heap of questions for those things. Have they all gone now?
Well, I think it's sort of, I think it all comes together. You know, there's little things I'd like to clarify in some of the things you said, but I don't think that, I feel that you've got the message across.
Yeah.
And there's other questions I'm trying to formulate
so
about.
If that's the case, can I just say a bit more about the expression of will? Is that all right?
Please, continue.
Well, most people I notice who are in stagnation, which is actually demonstrating they're in resistance, right? Most people I notice, they always come up and they say, I don't understand why I'm in resistance. I don't understand why I'm stagnant. And to me, this smacks of irresponsibility.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you understand how the soul works, you would go, instead of going that, you'd say, I am stagnant because I am choosing to be. Right?
And this is where the understanding of our will, which is what God really wants us to understand mm-hmm. in this earth incarnation.
Or in our entire life, in fact.
Yeah, but this earth incarnation, I feel, is very purposeful to help us really see the expression of our will in mm-hmm. action and mm-hmm. to become sensitive to that.
Mm-hmm.
And when we are saying, oh, I don't know why, when we're really missing that first very crucial lesson that we have a will, aren't we?
Not only that crucial lesson, we're missing this crucial lesson, that we are responsible for the exercise of our will.
Sorry, that's what I meant, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, so we have a will, we need to understand that. But we also need to understand that we, and like me, I, and only I, are responsible for the exercise of my own will. No one else can do it for me. No one, not even God, will do it for me. So if I am stagnant, the only reason why I am stagnant is because of something I am choosing to do.
Mm-hmm.
This is an expression, resistance is an expression of my will. So when I am in resistance, I have a responsibility to find out why I have chosen to be in resistance. And it is a choice. There is a soul-based emotional choice going on inside of me that causes me to wish to remain resistant.
Mm-hmm.
And I need to take responsibility and say that I have created it and I need to release it if I want to change. And it doesn't matter how many teachers I have and it doesn't matter how many people I have helping me and it doesn't matter how many times I talk about it and it doesn't matter how many times I hear something about it. Unless I am willing to work, get to the emotion inside of me that causes this resistance, and unless I am willing
feel
to take responsibility
yeah.
to feel that emotion, I will not change. And it doesn't matter how many people try to help me, it doesn't matter how long they try to help me, it doesn't matter what magical things they can do to help me, I will not change until I go through that emotional experience. And that is the pain and suffering that's mentioned in the Paget messages that every spirit who has ever arrived in the spirit world has to go through in order to start embracing the full use of their will. There is always pain and suffering associated with the unlawful exercise of our own will. And I say unlawful from the point of view of God's laws.
Mm-hmm.
Every time we exercise our will unlawfully, out of harmony with God's loving laws, we are going to have to go through a painful emotional experience now or later. Doesn't matter when, it's going to have to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And we will not change on that issue until it happens, mm-hmm. until we actually go through that painful emotional experience. And this is where I feel people need to understand responsibility. They are responsible for where they are right now. They are responsible for their own resistance. No one else can help them through their own resistance if they are unwilling to do it.
Yeah.
They need to exercise their will.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel that it would be great to have a discussion about will with you at some time, because I know for myself, when we first moved in together, and I see this around many, many people that I know and meet, mm-hmm. which is why I bring it up, I didn't have an understanding of just how my will was being exercised in every way, like in every emotion, action, projection, all these things are all an expression of my will. Mm. And much of it I regarded as just normal.
And automatic.
Automatic. I hadn't ever considered how my will was being exercised. It was just in automatic. Mm. And I think perhaps that's why I feel so passionate about this lesson of the will, because I see that most people operate in automatic surrounding their will, and that's why they get to places where they go, oh, I don't know why I'm like this, because they really, it's not been inculcated into them, as you often say, that they have a will that they are responsible for. Mm. And I didn't want to be responsible because I didn't like being faced with
the truth about your will.
The truth about how I was using my will and the effects of how I was using my will.
Yes.
And because I'd never had much feedback, because I'd always been in sort of situations where people had agreement with me about how the will should be exercised around certain issues, areas, actions, situations. Mm-hmm. I'd never been confronted. And beginning to travel and things, that helped me, going to other countries, recognising more. But I just feel most people operate in a state of complete unawareness of the majority, not completely unaware that they have a will, but the majority or the multitude of ways in which a will is expressed in a day, and how that can be in harmony with love and truth or in harmony with error. Mm-hmm. I feel that most people... We are literally not raised to have that awareness.
No.
But we need it if we're going to deal with these things.
Yes. But also, while most people will understand that they make decisions intellectually, very few people actually understand that most of their decisions are made before they make the intellectual decision.
Yes.
Most of their decisions are made emotionally. They are set inside of their emotional condition. And their will is to either to retain that emotional condition rather than examine it honestly is quite strong. Like, you look at the majority of people who resist any discussion we have with them, the majority of times they are actively using their will to not examine themselves. They want to have no self-examination. All they want is for somebody to tell them, you're right. Mm. Now, if we were all right, we'd all be at one with God. We're not all right, and we need to understand that we're not, and the only way that we're going to become right is by releasing the error, the wrong, that's inside, and that is an emotional process. And you can try that intellectually till, you know, for the next 50 years, there'll be barely any change whatsoever, and the only change you will have made in that 50 years is the time you felt an emotion.
This is where, isn't it, there can be, it almost feels like there's layers of resistance.
Yep.
Because when you're speaking with someone who doesn't even want to see the emotional impediments, the errors within them that create their resistance, they don't even want to see, they even have resistance to the awareness that there is.
But even error. That is caused by an emotion.
It is.
Yeah, even like this is what I'm saying, every piece of resistance, even the intellectual denial that I have a problem, is caused by a feeling inside of me of why I want to deny. There's always something driven by the emotion. So even the thought, I want to deny this, which comes instantly, usually before the person formulates thought from a logical process, they're already denying it before they even think about what they're doing most of the time. That came from the entire inside emotional condition. Oh, I want to deny this. I want to get away from this pain that I'm going to have to feel if I go down that road. I want to deny that. And this is where we're using our will to deny our pain. And as soon as you do that, you're going to create error. You're going to create resistance. You're going to create resistance to truth, but you're also going to create error through addictive processes.
Yeah.
You're going to automatically have an addiction now where you're denying that pain. Every single pain you deny in yourself, an addiction will be created to correct it. And so for the majority of people, they've got thousands of pieces of pain that they're trying to deny in themselves from their childhood experience, and as a result they have thousands of addictions that they need to, emotional, most of them, that they're trying to suppress this pain with. And it's an automatic process driven by the soul's will. And we need to understand that it's the expression of the will. So you can't go, oh, I didn't know I was doing that. No, your soul is exercising the will, and God's not going to let you off the hook for that. God's not going to say, you say you didn't know that you wanted to murder somebody, or you say you didn't know you wanted to rape somebody, or you say you didn't know you wanted to yell and scream at your children and bash them. You say, you know, you say you didn't know that you wanted to have men look after you. Are you saying you didn't know these things? Because the reality is the majority of us know these things and deny them. That's the reality. We use our will to deny. We use our will to cover it all over. We use our will to create a facade. We use our will to not progress. So we can't then say that, oh, you know, why am I not progressing? It must be somebody else's fault. Maybe the teacher's at fault. Maybe, you know, maybe he taught me the wrong thing or whatever. No, God's a great teacher. God's trying to teach you every day. And if you're in resistance to God's teaching, it's because you're using your will to be so. That's the only reason why it's happening. Yeah. So these are important things to for people to understand, I feel.
So what I was wanting to ask you about before, about the layers of resistance, is simply about this thing that I find when I'm talking to people sometimes, and I feel it inside of myself as well, is like you can have a huge emotional resistance even to seeing
that you're
yourself.
Resistive.
Yeah. That you have resistance within you.
Yes.
And speaking to that person about issues of truth is very, very difficult because they don't want to see anything. Whereas then you can talk to someone who has worked through that emotion enough to allow the idea that they do have errors within them that are resisting truth. And that conversation is much easier.
Yes.
Because we're no longer, we don't have this emotional error inside of us that is saying there's nothing to see and I don't want to see.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of emotions that drive that, obviously. You know, for example, there's the emotion of don't tell me I've got something wrong with me because it means that I must be a terrible person, you know.
Yeah, lots of
don't, you know, there's so many emotions that drive these thoughts of resistance, and these emotional resistances need to be felt in order to be released. So if you have something come up where you automatically think somebody thinks you're a terrible person, well, it's probably that you have a feeling deep down that you're a terrible person that you need to feel. So feel it. Once you feel it and release that, then every conversation won't be tainted with the thought that maybe you're a terrible person. And that'll be fantastic for you. You'll be able to think with more clarity. You'll be able to act like you're not a terrible person all the time. You'll be able to be less suspicious about people's comments to you. Instead of believing they always think you're terrible, you'll think there might be some other motive as to why they're saying what they're saying, and so forth.
Yeah.
And, you know, unless you release that emotion, this emotion is going to taint every interaction in every part, every aspect of your life.
Yeah.
And you know, you see this happening every day with people. You go, there's another emotion that's tainting every aspect of your life. There's another one tainting every aspect of your life. And you're resistant to feeling that emotion. And as a result, you know, you've got to look through what's the emotion causing you to be resistive to feeling the emotion. And there's another emotion usually there.
Yeah.
You know, and these are usually things like shame, you know, feelings of fear that we don't want to feel, fear that we're a bad person, fear that, that there's something intrinsically wrong with us and things like that. These are all emotions that cause us to be very, very resistive to other emotions. It's sort of like, if you've got an emotion that causes you to be resistive to feeling other emotions,
yes.
Can you see that if you always skip over that emotion to feel that emotion, this emotion is going to slow down your progression, like in major ways. You're better off feeling that emotion, that emotion that wants you to be resistive to hearing feedback, the emotion that wants you to be resistive to feeling other emotions of sadness, guilt, shame, and other things. You're better off going through what's this feeling. And if this feeling is rage, then feel it. If, you know, don't take it out on other people. Feel it. Go into your bedroom, go into a private place, feel it, express it, get it out of you, connect with it. Then it'll drop away.
Yeah.
And when it drops away, it's like then it's free sailing into the next emotion.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. So we got that they're under the control of our will.
Okay, so I think I've made that plain.
So I'll scrap
and that
it.
We are responsible. God created us to be self-responsible beings. And every time we go, I don't know why this is happening, we're not being a self-responsible being. We're not exercising our will to find out.
Yeah.
You know, God wants us to exercise our will to find out everything. Everything. Everything about the universe, everything about ourselves. And we need to be self-responsible beings to do that. So one of the things, lessons we need to learn is I need to become a self-responsible being where I acknowledge that if I am not progressing, it's because I am exercising my will to do so. Is that enough eyes and minds for everybody?
Yeah, I don't know, but it probably needs saying.
Yeah.
Okay.
So how about we talk about the adult child contrast?
Yeah. Yep, let's do that.
Yep.
So as an adult, my resistance is under my control.
Definitely.
It's my responsibility.
My responsibility. I am the only person that can change it.
Yeah. Whereas as a child, a few different things happen, don't they?
Of course. There's
a child doesn't have a developed sense of itself.
Correct.
Or its will, and it's very much at the mercy of its environment, isn't
Correct.
It?
Correct. So what we've just said applies primarily to adults. If you're talking at a child under the age of seven, a child, particularly under the age of seven, because that's by the time they get to 7 years of age, they usually have now a fully developed brain, so they have the same kind of senses that we generally have as adults, generally, and they have some connection to their emotional state usually still, but they also have now some sense of logic, some understanding of the world, and by this stage now they're starting to exercise their own will to small degrees, which increase through the teenage years until they're exercising their will completely. Mm-hmm. Now, when a child is a child, as you correctly point out, there is a large amount of external control on that child.
Yep.
And so the child having or doing something is largely the expression of its environment's will.
Mm-hmm.
So if our child is screaming in the middle of the room and yelling and screaming at us, and the child's three, it's largely an expression of the person he's screaming at,
mm-hmm.
their will. There's something inside of them that's causing resistance that causes this child to act in this manner.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it might be an allowance of being controlled that causes the child to attempt the control,
yep.
for example. And that is the thing we're resisting inside of ourselves as an adult. Right? But we can't say that the child is fully developed its will and so therefore the child is fully self-responsible for that action. Now, obviously, as the child's growing, it's becoming self-responsible, and we want to teach it to be self-responsible,
mm-hmm.
but we can't teach a child to be self-responsible if we, as an adult, are not responsible.
Yeah.
If we disclaim all responsibility for our own life, how can we ask the child to be responsible for its own life?
Yeah. So you're talking about there about responsibility of the child and resistance within the adult.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to ask you about how resistance is created within the child.
Yes.
Because obviously, as an adult, that resistance, the emotional beliefs and feelings are within me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if they're truthful, they create resistance to error. If they're error-based, they create resistance to truth.
Yes.
But as a child, it's almost as if we arrive with no resistance.
Correct. Well, and particularly when we arrive with no resistance at the time of conception, not at the time of birth.
Yep.
By the time we reach the time of birth, we already have some of the resistances of our parents already in our soul. So if you say at the time of conception, the child's soul has a complete openness to the environmental experience.
Mm-hmm.
And it has no developed intellect to prevent the environmental emotional experience. So as a result, it starts absorbing the emotional experiences of its environment. Right? So if the father, for example, when the child is conceived, projects at the child that he doesn't want it,
yep.
then in that moment, the child feels the emotion without having any intellectual barrier against it. The child feels that emotion and he's got no emotional barrier against it. So the emotion that of the father's, you know, desire to not have the child enters the child. So the child will feel from that moment that daddy didn't want me. And unless daddy changes his emotion, you know, like a month later he might decide he really wants the child will feel that too.
Yeah.
Like the child will be open to the absorption because there is no impediment or resistance affecting the stopping of the absorption. So the absorption will naturally occur. So this is where it becomes critical. What are the parents' emotions towards the child in particular?
Because they go on to create the resistances, either truthfully or error-based.
Correct.
Resistances that are
in the child. Yep.
So just to clarify something that you said as you were talking, about the child not having an intellectual barrier to...
Or an emotional barrier.
Or an emotional barrier with
which to... So there's no developed intellect because the child hasn't got a developed brain at this point. And there's no emotional barrier because there's no truth-based emotion inside of the child's soul that would resist the feeling coming towards it.
But it might be truth that's entering the child.
It might be
truth. And there's no error that's there to resist it also.
So this is the beautiful thing about our child.
Yep.
The child will experience every emotion of truth that's in the parent and it will enter the child. Mm. And the child will experience every emotion of error that's in the parent and that will enter the child. Now, you think of the potential of that.
I often think of that.
Yeah, it's just amazing, the potential of that. Imagine if every child only experienced the emotions of truth and love that entered the child and no emotions of error and hatred and fear that enter the child ever.
Yeah.
By the time the child's born, it is completely open to the absorption of truth. And so it's going to pick up truth, bang, 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 like... It's going to be so rapid by the time it's three, it's going to be speaking 2,500 languages. It's going to be, you know, mathematical genius. It's going to be playing musical instruments, doing whatever it desires because there's no resistance that came from the parents.
That is in, there's resistance, but it's to error, not to truth.
Correct, correct. Because if we do it right as parents, there'd be resistance to error and no resistance to truth.
Yeah.
And that is an amazing place, potentially, for the child. Of course, there's never been a child on this earth that's ever experienced that.
No.
But that is the potential of our experience.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you think about that potential, it's amazingly wonderful.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing, hey? Mm. Now, going back to my question.
Yeah.
You said that there's no intellectual or emotional barrier with which the child can prevent the truth or the error entering them.
Yes.
To me, that implies that as an adult with a developed intellect, we can present an intellectual barrier. Is that what you're meaning to convey?
Well, it can assist you with your emotional absorptions, certainly,
okay.
Because you can use logic to help a person see that their emotional impediment must be an error. Do you understand what I mean by
yes.
that? So I can reason with you and say, okay, your concept of love is that you can defend your family to the death. Now, if every family took that approach, then of course probably there'd be a lot of deaths, right?
Yes.
If I killed your child, you killed my child, I killed your brother, you killed my brother, I killed your wife, you killed my wife, and I killed your husband, By then none of us will be left.
Yeah.
Not very logical.
No.
So you can appeal to the logic of the individual and show them, okay, there is a problem with one of their soul-based beliefs inside of their soul that causes them to accept this belief that they can defend themselves to the death and prove to them through logic that it's an error. Now, of course, they don't still know it's an error.
No.
Or know that it's the truth, what you've just said.
From a soul perspective.
From a soul's perspective, because they haven't released the error yet. They haven't released the emotional reason why they believe they should be able to defend themselves to the death.
Yeah.
Right? So they haven't done that. But you can help them at least logically see that such a belief must be an error. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now, with a child, you can't do that very easily, particularly if it's in the womb. You can't do it at all.
Mm-hmm.
And if a child's just a baby without any formed intellect or method of communication verbally, you can't do it then either. It's only after they get to talk and start speaking and stuff like that that you can start to do those kind of things with the child. But you can do it with the adult.
Yep. So it's about employing logic, but also it sounds like it's about an issue of choice. An adult can use their intellect to choose, I'm going to listen to this person and not listen to that person? I'm going to walk away?
Well, the choice is in the soul still, but we can use our intellect to help us come to some kind of thing, resolution in the soul where we now make a different choice, right? So we can say, okay, my current choice is not logical. My current choice causes me to cause all this damage to other people.
Yep.
Do I want emotionally to keep doing that? Mm-hmm. Do I still want to hurt my children? Is a good question most parents need to ask themselves.
Yeah.
Because if they are truthful about it, many parents would have to say, yes, I do want to keep hurting my children. If I'd rather hurt my children than feel my own pain. Most parents actually truthfully are in that state. But if we get beyond that state and we start going intellectually, do I want this to stay the same? I would then go to find the emotional, I'd use my mind to find the emotional reason and experience the emotional reason as to why I feel like that. Mm-hmm. And this is where you can use logic and reasoning to assist a person to grow. But you can't grow without doing the emotional change.
It almost feels like sometimes to me that we employ our mind as a last resort to try to work our way back through the resistances that have been put up emotionally from a soul perspective to try and even get in touch with them. And a lot of times kids are just more connected to their
It's a lot easier with a child.
Yeah.
With a child, like if I sit down with a child for a minute, usually you can get them into the emotional reason as to why they chose to take an action that was unloving.
Mm.
But as
Without
an adult,
really even engaging
you can spend
intellect.
Months and months and months. I've spent 5 years with some people talking with them every single day for every week for 5 years, and they still haven't seen that their action was unloving after all of that.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter how much logic you use, because they're unwilling to address the emotional reason inside of them, they won't change.
Yeah.
And yet with a child, you can do it 5 minutes, 10 minutes, usually it's all done. A lot of times with a child, particularly if it's a younger child, like 3 or 4 years of age, you can just hold them and feel with them, and they go through the emotional experience.
Yeah.
Like, you know, try doing that with an adult and come out unscathed. For most adults, it would potentially kill you before they allowed that to occur.
No, it's just interesting about kids, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it is such a dream to have a child just absorb truth. And the resistance to error within that child, if that was absorbed by the time they're seven, just it would be fairly...
Well, there'd be none.
Change the world.
There'd be no resistance to... There'd be resistance to error and there'd be no resistance to truth.
Mm.
How remarkable would that child be?
Yeah.
You know, that kind of child by the time it's 7 or 8 years of age would be standing in front of worldwide audiences showing them truth, you know.
Yeah.
The child's not going to be frightened, scared, he's not going to have any fear in him, he's going to be able to express himself very clearly, connected with his emotions at all times. You know, our potential as a human race is so great, you know, even on Earth, if we understood how the soul worked.
Yeah.
But only if we understand how the soul works.
Yeah. And if we live our lives in according to the
principles.
In accordance with the principles of how the soul functions.
Yes.
Like, we wouldn't waste so much time trying to get solutions using other methods.
No.
We wouldn't parent in a way that ignores the soul.
And we wouldn't spend millions and billions and billions of dollars on remedy processes, on finding the next pill to cure a problem. And, you know, honestly, we have huge amounts of wasted time on this planet because we are so focused in preventing pain. We have huge amounts of wasted time that goes into preventing the soul experience, which is the opposite direction we need to take. Now, if you could generate a pill that could help you feel some emotion, that would be a far better use of your time than generating a pill that suppresses it. You know what I mean? So all this anti-depression medication and everything that goes on suppressing emotion, like, honestly, you'd be far better off developing a pill that allows the experience of emotion in a safe manner than you would, like, developing a pill to suppress the emotion.
But that pill would never work, though, because you can't overcome the dominance of the soul some people who take drugs, illicit drugs, would say, oh, it helps me experience my emotions, but it doesn't, because
you're experiencing it with someone else.
with someone else, usually with some spirits involved, and the resistance towards certain emotional experiences
is still there.
Is still in place. Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Anyway, all right.
Okay.
Is that all we got on resistance?
No, I feel we need to go through each point that I wanted to raise because you're not.
We
haven't discussed all of them. I want to discuss next the. The fact that we're allowed to resist. You know, I feel quite strongly that we need to see that we are allowed to resist anything we want. One part of the exercise of our will is that we are allowed to exercise our will to resist. It's very interesting what happens inside of us psychologically when we go through this process of acknowledging that we are allowed to resist. Because what often happens is we don't resist anymore after that. And it's very interesting from a psychological perspective about why that is. A lot of our resistance is generated by a feeling of rebellion. And when we say to ourselves and when we acknowledge inside of us emotionally that we're allowed to rebel, we then start questioning why we'd want to. And once we start questioning that, usually we start going through the emotion. And I find a lot of people, you know, when we start saying to you're resistive, they go, am I? And I say, but you're allowed to resist. Oh, I don't feel like I am. I can't, you know. And if they just, for a change, acknowledge that they're allowed to, that God's given them a free will, so that means they're allowed to use their will to resist.
Yeah.
A lot of the times that when they say, oh, I'm just resisting feeling fear, then a lot of times they start feeling fear.
Yeah.
When they say, oh, I'm just resisting feeling sad, then they start going, oh, I'm resisting feeling sad. I'm allowed to resist. And then start crying, you know, like a lot of the times. And that's because we need to acknowledge that it's our will that's involved with the resistance as to why that process occurs. And I feel that's very, very important for people to understand. You need to acknowledge that you are allowed to resist. You're allowed to be stagnant. Stop blaming other people for it. It's your choice. But you're allowed to choose that. If that's your choice, you're allowed to choose it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting, psychologically, when you see that you're allowed to, you will often feel less rebellion towards the emotion that causes that resistance. So I feel that's a very important point most people need to understand.
Yeah. I'm just thinking about it in terms of truth, because we have resistance to error when we're in truth and resistance to truth when we're in error. But you're stating that the acknowledgement of the resistance allows us to simply feel the emotion which is in play more freely.
It's not the acknowledgement of the resistance, because that's one part. What I'm talking about here is not the acknowledgement.
It's the will-based part.
No, I'm talking about the acknowledgement that I'm allowed to resist.
Yep.
That's a different thing than acknowledging the resistance itself.
Yep.
Can you see it's two separate things?
Yes, I can see it.
On one hand, I'm allowed to see I'm allowed to resist, and the other one, I'm seeing what I'm resisting, which is two different processes.
Yes, yep.
And I am allowed to resist what I don't, you know, I'm allowed to not see. I'm allowed to choose to not see.
Yeah.
If I can give a closer illustration of how that may work. Often I find with people who feel, you start seeing the tears run down their face, but they don't want to cry, right? And you say to them, look, you're allowed to cry. And they go, I know, I just can't, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I go, you're allowed to not cry. You're allowed to shut it down if you want. And oftentimes after I say that, they burst out crying. Now, why is that? Because they've now acknowledged that they're allowed to make a choice to resist. And they then automatically start questioning why they're making that choice emotionally.
Mm-hmm.
They question it immediately. And this is something we need to understand. It's very different. So it's very different from the will part of it, this is. What we're saying is resistance is all about the exercise of our free will. You know, I'm allowed, and what we're saying is, when we're in denial, we're exercising our free will to deny, but we also need to acknowledge that we're allowed to deny.
Yeah.
We're allowed to not cry. We're allowed to not feel our fear. We're allowed to not feel our shame. We're allowed to not feel anything if we want.
Yeah.
You know, you'll probably get depressed like that, but that's you're allowed to do it if you want. You're allowed to create depression. You're allowed to create a disease. If that's what you want to do to avoid all your emotions, you're allowed to do all of those things and God will let you do it. God will let you do it because you're allowed to, right? And then once we acknowledge that we are allowed to, oftentimes we start getting into the actual emotion that causes us to want to.
Yeah.
And that's very different than just, you know, saying we're allowed to feel or not feel our emotion. Because what we're doing psychologically is we're acknowledging the power of our will.
So, and how it's being exercised.
And how it's being exercised.
Yeah.
Yes. And that's a very powerful thing to help you through resistance.
Mm. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Okay, so this one's a pearler for me. I wonder why I wanted to skip it.
Yeah, I felt you were skipping quite a few things here, so we had to go back to them.
We can't actually surrender to fully and to experience a causal emotion. So we can't actually release, which is what's required to release a causal emotion.
Yes.
While there still exists within us any form of resistance to that emotion.
Surrender. And to surrender
and
as well.
And to surrender.
Yes. So if we have resistance to experiencing the emotion, and we have resistance to the process of surrender, which is being, it's basically resistance to the process of allowing yourself to be overwhelmed by emotion, then you're going to find it very, very difficult to experience the emotional error.
Yep.
Because all emotional error is painful to experience.
Mm-hmm.
There's always pain associated with emotional error. And as a result of the emotional error being painful, we're going to want to avoid it.
Yeah.
And unless we understand that, unless we understand that that the desire to avoid the emotional error and the desire to be overwhelmed, right, to not allow ourselves to be overwhelmed, I should say, will cause the resistance to experiencing the emotion.
Yeah.
So sometimes I see people getting close to the emotion and then this other secondary emotion, which is really a big emotion, kicks in, and that's the emotion of not wanting to be overwhelmed. So they don't allow themselves to be overwhelmed. And so a few little trickles come down their face and they go, oh, it's wonderful to connect to that. And I'm saying, you haven't even started connecting to that yet. You know, you're allowed to not cry. You're allowed to choose to suppress the big grief that's inside of you that you need to experience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's so funny talking about it because you're so lighthearted and just joyous and enthusiastic about it. But to me, it's still very much a serious business, so I can feel in this. Yeah. So I'm apologising for my seriousness about this because, but...
But you have experienced, haven't you, personally, the experience of not wanting to surrender, even though you know the emotion is there to surrender to.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I feel most people have had that experience where they feel an emotion inside of them that wants to come out and they keep it under control. And that's a fear of surrender or a fear of being overwhelmed by the emotion, which is caused by all other kinds of emotions, like worried about what other people think, worried about what it's going to look like, worried about how people are going to react, and all those kind of things cause those suppressions of that emotion.
And false beliefs about survival of emotion, all kinds of crazy
and that it's never going beliefs. To be never-ending.
Yeah.
A lot of people feel that. It's like, if I start feeling that, I'll be still feeling that 10 years' time. That's a physical impossibility, actually, with the soul. It's physically impossible to feel an emotion in its pure state for 10 years.
Yeah.
5 years or 3 years, or 2 years or 1 year even. It's physically impossible. Yeah. If you're feeling emotion for 1 year, then you're not feeling it in its pure state.
Yeah.
It's usually hours and sometimes days and very, very unusual circumstances and conditions, weeks.
Isn't that just kind of crazy to the point of almost farcical,
yeah.
that we spend so much energy avoiding something that could be over in 2 or 3 hours.
Yes.
And this is the power of these error-based beliefs that create resistance.
Correct.
They are so powerful, aren't they?
Well, they're powerful, but they're not more powerful than God's love or anything. But they are powerful.
We give them power.
We give them power.
Over our life.
We honour them.
Yeah.
Because we have such an honour of fear, we honour the emotion that keeps us locked up. And yet, and in a way, it's sort of like we nurse it in our bosom, you know. We hold it to ourselves, you know, and want to keep it with us the rest of our life for some reason. You know, we have almost this longing to do so. And yet...
I don't feel like that.
Yeah, you do, because you are doing it. See, again...
It's not an affectionate feeling, though.
For many, it is an affectionate feeling, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah.
You can almost feel the nostalgia in them when they're talking
yes,
about it.
Yes.
And I've had many conversations with you where there is a nostalgia about wanting to hold on to a specific emotion, and that's all about, oh, I want to nurse this thing, I want to feel this way, you know, for the rest of my life if I can, type of thing.
Yeah, and a lot of people romanticize pain.
Definitely.
If you've been raised by someone who romanticizes pain, you can get nostalgic about your sadness.
Well, because you have an emotional addiction to romanticizing pain.
Yeah.
Because what happens is you get approval from that parent by romanticizing pain yourself.
Yeah.
And that's very dangerous when you do that. It's very dangerous for your own progression.
Yeah.
And these are all blockages or errors
that
cause resistance in your soul to the growth
that
needs to occur. And this is what I was saying. It's just like most people are there holding this stuff to themselves, you know, in almost a worshipful state about the emotion. When I say worshipful, what I mean is they honour that fear above all else.
Mm.
That the fear of the emotion is greater than love. It's greater than truth. It's greater than anything. It's greater than their partner. It's greater than their own children. They'll abuse, you know, by maybe even assault them physically, or even just yell and scream at them verbally just to avoid this pain.
Yeah.
You know, this is telling you that it's greater than your idea or concept of love.
Yeah.
Fear inside of you causes this. And it's sad that it gets to this state, but we need to see that state and we need to start feeling the emotion in that state as to why that is.
Yeah.
Why are we so afraid to feel pain?
Yeah.
There's a major problem in the humanity. Why are we so afraid to feel it? Now, sure, we have beliefs like, for example, we have beliefs that it will be never ending. Well, that's just a false belief. God knows it's never ending.
It's not never ending.
God knows that it's not never ending. So God knows that it will end. If you don't know it will end, then you're not connected with God in that state. You know, it's just a false belief you have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, God created your soul for all this pain to end. God created this foolproof system where all the pain eventually has to leave you. It will leave you one way or the other. You just got to embrace the process. And if you understood the process better, you might embrace it more.
Yeah.
That's why we're going through this material of how the soul functions.
Yeah. So on this point, though, we're saying that while there's resistance within us to the state of surrender, we're not going to release surrender towards a causal emotion.
Yep.
We're not going to be able to release that emotion.
Correct.
So we must be willing to feel the error.
And feel the resistance. We've got to feel the reason why we don't want to be overwhelmed by that emotion.
Yeah.
That's what we've got to feel.
Yeah.
That's the error we've got to release. Feel why you don't want to be overwhelmed.
Yeah.
Now, there's a lot of judgments on this planet about emotion. Man, the amount of criticism we get from people about emotion, it's intense. You get that criticism every single day in your life. You know, it's society-based criticism about feeling emotion. And this is why most of us don't do it.
Yeah.
Because we're so afraid of society, we're so afraid of what everyone else thinks, that we don't go through the natural process that a child goes through, that God created us to go through, to release error and embrace truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
Have I interrupted you?
No, that's all right. That's all right. I feel that what you're saying is so important.
Yeah.
But... And I don't want to make it too jumbly for the listener, but we're talking about the need to surrender to causal emotion.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about removing the error, which creates the resistance to that state.
the resistance to surrender.
Yes, to the state of surrender. Mm-hmm. And earlier on in your introduction to this principle, you said something. You said that there's not much resistance in grief.
Mm-hmm. True grief.
Yes.
So grief is the causal emotion.
Yes.
Right? So when a person is feeling true grief, usually in that state, they're not resistive to their emotion. It's quite good. You know, usually by the time a person's got to that state, they've already gone through all the resistances needed to get to that state. Right? So generally, most people, by the time they get to true grief, and I'm not talking about manufactured grief or rebellious grief or angry grief,
yep,
or any of those other types of things which are not grief at all, but rather rebellion.
Yep.
Well, I'm talking about the true feeling of grief within the soul. Then usually most of their emotional impediments about feeling that emotion have disappeared by that stage,
uh-huh,
about that particular subject.
Yeah.
Right. It's the process of getting there which is littered with huge amounts of resistive emotions, huge amounts of error-based emotions and error-based beliefs, which are all emotional, which cause us to not want to be overwhelmed by grief.
Yes.
Right? And that is usually the work we need to do. Finding them and releasing them. Feeling them is the only way to release them. So you've got to feel every one of them. And that's the work that we need to allow ourselves to go through the process. Now, if you receive some of God's love, it softens your soul to feeling.
Mm-hmm.
So it's higher, more highly likely you'll go through the process if you receive some of God's love. But if you don't receive some of God's love, you're still going to have to go through the process. It's just without God that you're going to have to go through the process. And that's going to be a long, labour-intensive process.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, I don't necessarily recommend. But it's better than not doing it at all. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If you're going to choose to do it without God, then at least do it. Don't put it off altogether, you know, which is what most people do on earth.
Yeah.
They put it off altogether.
Yeah.
But the reality is we need to talk later and in another session about the relationship between God's love and how it softens the soul and how it can help all of these aspects of the soul grow,
yeah,
and therefore soften the soul into the feeling state that it needs to have in order to progress.
Mm.
But often people have a lot of resistance about feeling God's emotion too. So we've got to talk about these things before they'll even feel some of God's emotion.
Yep. Okay.
Does that answer the point though that you were getting at? Not really.
Not really, but
so what was the point you're getting at?
No, I wasn't actually I'm not able, obviously by now it's obvious, not able to articulate the point very
well.
So
what is it you're trying to say?
No, I don't know.
So what's the problem you're facing?
The question
why do you feel it's unresolved? There's a reason inside of you why something feels unresolved here.
It just seems
there's a resistance in your soul. Go on.
Yeah, no, I just think it seems very beautiful and crucial to recognise that by the time we get to feeling the causal emotion, there is very little resistance to truth within us in that place, from what you're saying.
No, only towards that emotion.
Yes.
This is what we must understand, that it's not towards every emotion.
No.
It's only towards that emotion that there's much less resistance to our feeling, right?
Yes.
That's only one emotion.
So on a certain issue,
yep,
when we get rid of a lot of the anger, fear, judgment, shame,
blockages, society, beliefs, all these kind of
false
things.
False beliefs.
Yep.
All of those things create the resistance that we have to truth around this one subject. We're just talking about one subject.
One subject. It might be mummy treated me badly.
Or, yeah. Or women don't. Women are never going to love me.
Yeah.
And
just whatever the one subject is.
Whatever the one subject is. And I just thought it was very interesting that you said that once you deal with all of that and you actually get to some causal grief,
mm-hmm,
this resistance that we talked about that prevents the flow of truth into your soul, once you're actually feeling that, you are through it.
Pretty much, yeah. And this is what allows God's love to operate upon your soul as well in,
yep,
that place, because now that you're open to feeling the actual causal feeling that causes you to that causes you to retain this belief, you're feeling and experiencing it, And since you're feeling and experiencing it, it's leaving you. And at the time it's leaving you, truth can enter you. At the same time now, it's yes. like pouring out water out of a bowl. You can now fill it up again. And if you imagine a bowl turned upside down, like a bottle turned upside down with a lid on the end and open at the top, you try pouring water in the top and it's already filled, all the water goes everywhere and none goes in the bottle, right? So, you know, obviously, if we talk about scientifically, it's a bit different than that, but I'm talking about just general analogy. You open the bottle at the bottom and all that other water goes out. Now, when you pour water in the top, water can go in. And your soul is very similar to that. The water can go in, truth can go in, while you're letting error out.
And that's, I suppose that's what I was trying to get to, is that in the preamble to this discussion, we talked about the emotional impediment as error that prevents the absorption of truth. And the magic of what you're saying is when we're in a state of surrender to that causal emotion, that emotional impediment is...
It's being released
it's
now.
It's being released.
It's being released. It hasn't been completed released.
No.
But it's being released.
Yeah.
So through the process of being released, new truth can enter. Gradually, of course, as the emotion is released. So if you choose to hold that process up because something challenges you and you don't let yourself be overwhelmed anymore, then you only released a certain amount and the truth will only enter that amount.
Yeah.
And now there's still some kind of resistance that caused you to stop that process.
Yeah.
And you need to find it and let it flow again. Right? Truth will enter to the extent that you let the error leave. It's just a simple equation. One is going to have to make way for the other. Quite simple. So if we let a little bit of it go, a little bit of it can enter. And this is how most of us process emotion. We let a little bit of error go, a little bit of truth enters, a little bit more error goes, a little bit of truth enters. The reality is that we could allow that process more, but only if we allow surrender and being overwhelmed. And for most people, they don't allow that. They allow dribble here, dribble there, dribble here, dribble there. And try emptying a bottle with a dribble. It's going to take days. You know, if you empty a bottle with a whoosh, it'll take hours or minutes. And this is how our soul works too. There are many emotions in us that we could solve within hours, but we don't allow that process to fully complete. We stop it because of some fear or some other false belief. And as a result, it takes days, months, or even years to make the transition.
And while we're resisting, we're actually attempting to limit, while we're resisting truth, while we're holding on to error, or the error within us is resisting the truth, then we're just limiting our own growth, aren't we?
Well, this is the sad thing, isn't it? Like, we're there holding on to resistance, saying, I want to hold on to resistance, I need to rebel against the whole process, I don't want to change. And all you're really doing is limiting your own growth, which would result in your own happiness. So you're limiting so many things. Why would you logically take a step that causes you to limit your own happiness? Doesn't make much sense, right? And this is the sad thing about pain that we don't understand. While we retain the pain within, we are limiting the pleasure that we can experience. It doesn't make much sense to do that. See, this is where logic can be used to help a person get into the reasons why they resist rather than just, you know, allowing resistance to remain the rest of their life. We need to challenge our stagnation. And one way of challenging our stagnation is to at least reason with ourselves logically about what stagnation is achieving. And the reality for most of us is stagnation achieves you not having to feel pain.
But in the long term.
But in the long term, it creates huge amounts of pain. So you could actually say stagnation achieves a fixed amount of pain that gradually grows. Like, and the majority of us prefer that than being overwhelmed by pain for a short period of time.
That then decreases.
And that's pretty sad.
It is, isn't it?
That we actually prefer that. So there's a lot in resistance. Of course, we could talk for hours about you know, what emotions cause resistance, what kind of emotions of resistance there are. And when we answer people's questions about emotional processing, emotional growth, we'll probably start addressing some of these issues in more clarity. Yeah. So I think later in the week we're doing a section of questions about emotions, and they'll all be referencing the human soul FAQ, because in the end they'll all revert back some way to what's going on with one of these principles of the how the soul functions.
I'm looking forward to that. Thanks. Thanks for that discussion, babe, and thanks for your passion and enthusiasm on the topic.
Well, I love how the soul functions. To me, learning about how the soul function has helped me immensely in my own life.
Yeah.
And I feel that if everyone on earth knew how the soul function, we would drop, like, honestly, the entire economies of nations would change into focusing on growth rather than focusing on suppression and dealing with the effects of resisting change in the soul. So I feel understanding this material has a powerful effect on the individual, but also potentially a powerful effect on humanity, collectively.
Thank you.
Thank you.